launch of Hijabistan, which is a collection of short stories written by Sabyn Javeri. Sabine's previous novel was called Nobody Killed Her, which was loosely inspired by the assassination of Benazir Bhutto, but was a work of fiction on its own. Hijabistan is a collection of short stories. The name is, of course, very intriguing, and I think a lot of people would want to go and check out the book just because of the title. This is a collection of stories which explores female sexuality, I would say, with a primary focus on Pakistani women or women of Pakistani origin. That seems to be the primary area of focus. And what's interesting about it is that it explores that sexuality across a spectrum. So we're looking at women who are privileged, we're looking at women who are not, we're looking at women who live in Pakistan, women who live abroad, we're looking at women who are mothers, women who are working women, who are not mothers. So there's a large collection of characters here, but the theme that runs through these stories is to sort of lift the veil, as it were, on these women's lives and to uncover and to unpack the idea of female sexuality and how it plays out in a society that tends to want to cover that. So I hope I've done justice in terms
of... Actually, you've described it better than I could have. So thank you for that.
Okay, so Sabyn, what you've done here in terms of contemporary English fiction coming out of Pakistan, this is something very different. It's something new. It's something quite exciting. And I would say, in a way, also something very brave, because this is a topic that's not easy to write about for public consumption, and yet you've done it. And I think it's extraordinary that you were sort of drawn in this direction and motivated enough to actually take this on and to see this project through. I would love to know, what were the origins of this project for you? What made you come in this direction?
Okay, so I think the, first of all, thank you so much for putting it so elegantly and eloquently. I think what really drew me to this was Ismet Chugtai's short story, Lihaf. And I was studying in Oxford when I first came across it in an English translation. And what I found really shocking was here was a female writer writing in Urdu in 1900s, tackling a topic like female sexuality and child abuse. And I thought, why are we not in the contemporary South Asian world writing about stories that really matter to us as women today? Along with that, it was shocking for me that we still face the same kind of issues and we still have the same concerns, and there's so little talked about things which are of primary concern to us. So that kind of triggered off the idea, and the idea of the hijab was, again, because these are the things that we cover up. Again, it was loosely inspired by Lihaf, because, you know, the story is told from under the blanket, what she saw from under the blanket. And, you know, that whole idea of covering up things which are extremely important, things which matter. And for me, I think that is the real hijab, that is the real curtain, that is the real divider. And I wanted to explore in my short stories, what is it that we are not talking about? I think we focus a lot on stories that we want to tell, but we pay very little attention to the stories that we want to hide. And for me, in this book, I wanted to bring out the stories that we don't want to tell anyone. And you're right, I think when you're doing something, you're not so conscious of it, but afterwards, when the repercussions you're faced with, then you get to know. Now I feel that it was brave and maybe perhaps stupid as well, because you know, people are, these are taboo topics, and it is hard for people to digest, and it is hard for people to accept that, you know, a respectable person would be talking about it. And I've had colleagues, friends come up to me slightly embarrassed and say, why are you writing about these things? Koi achhi si cheez nahi mili, terrorism pe hi likh leti. I'm like, haan.
Kyunki us pe to kisi ne nahi likha.
Haan, us pe to koi likh hi nahi raha. To ab kya kar sakte.
So in Nobody Killed Her, we had a strong female protagonist at the center of it. In these stories also, the fact that in every story, the protagonist is a woman. And in each, in her own way, is doing something courageous or something different in terms of what is expected of her by society. Would you say that the Pakistani woman functions almost as a muse for you? Or is it perhaps too early to say that, and are you going to do something totally different, say, with your third book? But do you feel that the Pakistani woman inspires you in any particular way?
Okay, so that's very interesting what you say, because one of the things that I have noticed in my formal education is that history is always told from the point of view of a victor. History is in some sense his story, you know. And I think what I'm interested in is her story. I'm interested in different point of views. And often the female point of view for me is the alternate point of view. It's a very organic, grassroots, holistic way of looking at things. We were talking earlier about how one of the differences between women's writing and men's writing is that women seem to approach fiction from a very holistic grassroots point of view. Like, they would still be making a nationalistic critique, but it would probably be through, you know, pyaas ki price kitni badh gayi hai, you know. It would be from a very domestic sort of a point of view. It will take the domestic life into view. They tend to mix the personal with the political, you know.
An inner world, as it were. An inner world rather than the
outer
world. Exactly,
in one world. You know, their lens, the socio-critical commentary that they do is not isolated, you know. They take all these things into view. And I think that, for me, is more interesting rather than sort of mansplaining that, you know, this is the political situation, this is the enemy, this is, you know, how things are. I like approaching things from a more personal point of view, that how we got to a point where we got to. And I'm very interested in alternative revisionist narratives. It doesn't have to be fiction, even a non-fiction. For example, when I read Aisha Jalal's Sole Spokesman, Wazira Zamedar, it gave me an alternate narrative to the history of partition that we are taught. And I like incorporating these points of views in my story. However, I don't think I am limited to the Pakistani view, the Pakistani woman. Because one of the stories in this novel is called The Flyover, which is about, which is from the point of view of a male protagonist. And it is about how men too are oppressed in Pakistani society, how, you know, these expectations of this toxic masculinity are equally suppressing to men as well. This story talks about this boy who wants to be a poet, writer, but, you know, he's forced to become a provider because, you know, there's so much expectation, family expectations on this boy. He's married off because, you know, that's again custom. He's not ready to take the responsibility of a family. So I guess what I'm interested in, or what works as a muse for me, is a different way of looking at things, a very quirky, different view to how things are shown, you know, rather than whether it's from a man's point of view or from a woman's point of view. But it has to be something that is not the dominant narrative. You know, I want to look at things from the underdog's point of view.
And would you say that this is just an aesthetic choice, or, as you said, you're very interested in looking at it that way, or is it also, is there also an element of activism in it? Let's put it that way. I mean, I know that a lot of authors don't like to hear that, because they feel that they should be allowed to just write their fiction just for the sake of writing a good story, rather than having to think about that, will this change minds and will this influence people and change the world? But for you personally, is there an element of that when you write about these protagonists who are in some way struggling with something, and there's a social context to it? Do you think while writing that perhaps this will change someone's mind, or is that not a concern for you?
So I have no illusions that I can change the world. Agar main apne bachon ko hi change kar lu, I think that would be like, you know. But I think I think what I do hope is that my stories or my work will generate a debate. You know, it will create an awareness. And I think once you put something out there and a debate is generated about it and people notice it and they start talking about it, I think that itself is the initiator of a change. It may not make change happen instantly, but the fact that, you know, someone has brought this out in the open, someone is talking about it, discussing it, and there's, you know, a point of conversation, a forum. I think for me as a writer, that is enough. You know, that people are aware that there's something that needs to be discussed.
I wonder if this is a good time for you to, in fact, read a bit from the book so okay. that people get a sense of, I think, if you could read from An Irreplaceable Loss, that I think actually connects quite well with what we're talking about here in terms of starting a debate and getting people to think about something which is normalized and institutionalized in their everyday life, and maybe making them question it a little bit. I think this story would do a good job with that.
So this story is called An Irreplaceable Loss. It's from the point of view of a domestic worker. And again, one of the things that I was interested in is how women, and especially underprivileged women, are always victimized and their agency is dismissed automatically. You know, like Chimamanda Adichie once said in her famous TED talk about Two Sides to a Story, that, you know, if a narrative is about Africa, we automatically assume that all Africans are poor, deprived, malnourished. No one is willing to see that they are actually very, you know, there are things that they find joy in as well. So this is how that story was inspired. An irreplaceable loss. The girl felt as if she would explode. Nevertheless, she kept a straight face as the agent negotiated her pay with the new Baji. 24/7 rates, Baji. I am not just giving you a new maid, I am giving you my daughter. At least pay a few thousand more. The girl inhaled deeply, trying hard to stifle her laughter. She was neither young enough to be his daughter, nor he mature enough to act like someone's father. It was all she could do to hold back her laughter, for her sudden, uncontrollable fits of giggles had already cost her the last job where she had laughed at the Baji's new haircut. Or the one before, when she had laughed at the fat kid whose mother couldn't stop telling people how her son never ate anything. She sucked in her already sunken stomach and forced herself to think of the time she had cut her foot on a sharp piece of glass. Bajiji, she is a very hard worker, the agent was saying. Only 16, but works like a horse. The Baji looked her up and down, but didn't say anything. Don't go by her young looks. Believe me, she is very strong. The Baji looked skeptical, but remained silent. The silent type, the girl thought. Those were the toughest. No words. Slaps, kicks, straight away. Sometimes burns. She didn't feel like laughing so much now. Tough, tougher, toughest. Later, once the agent left her alone there, having taken half her salary in advance as his fee, the Baji finally turned to her. How old are you really? The girl tried hard to remember what the agent had told her. 15, she said, scratching her head. No, Baji, 16. The woman rolled her eyes and asked, what did you do in the last house? Dusting, sweeping, laundry. Why did you leave it? The girl shuffled a little and replied, my old Baji moved to Dubai. The woman in the chair threw back her head and laughed. You all have the same excuses. At this rate, there would be no Bajis left in all of Pakistan to hire you people. Everyone is moving to Dubai. The girl watched in fascination the Baji's pretty teeth and her melodious laughter, making a mental note to practice it quietly at night. When the woman stopped laughing, she asked, what's your name? Taranum, the girl replied. Real name, the Baji said, tapping her foot impatiently. Baji, that is my real name. She could tell the Baji didn't believe her, for her name meant melody. Hardly a name someone would give to the fifth daughter of a drug addict and a malnutrition mother who cleaned houses. You can ask the agent, the girl offered, seeing the suspicious look in the eyes of her new mistress. For surely her kind didn't think poor people could have the imagination to name their children so creatively. Anyhow, she consoled herself. She was used to this. None of the three houses she had worked at before had called her by her real name, finding it either too fake or too filmy. Call them, Baji. You can check. I'm not lying. No need. The woman waved a manicured hand with glossy pink nails at her. Look, I'll just call you. The Baji paused to think, and the girl admired the way her lashes seemed to roll back, the clumpy mascara only adding to the thickness. She smiled slightly, excited at the prospect of getting yet another new name. And sure enough, she did not have to wait too long. I'll just call you Tuba. The random sounds too... The Baji's voice trailed off, but her silence had said more than her words ever could. Doesn't sound like a maid's name, the girl completed the woman's sentence in her heart. Just then the woman's cell phone rang and the girl watched as she picked it up with her delicate fair hands and started speaking in English. The girl loved the sound of English and observed closely, picking up familiar words here and there, tucking them into her memory, the way she collected shells at the dirty garbage-filled beach her Abba took her to on Sundays, hoping to string them together in a necklace someday. Okay, okay, the Baji said, clicking off her phone and turning to where the girl sat on the floor. She looked distracted for a second, trying to remember the name she had given the new maid. Tuba? The girl supplied helpfully. Tuba. Yeah, the woman said. Saima, she bellowed, and a stocky middle-aged woman appeared almost instantly. Now listen, Tuba. Saima here is my oldest maid. She will show you the work around the house. You can share her quarters. Now look, I didn't argue about the salary, so you must not give me a reason to cut any. No going outside without my permission, no talking to the cook or driver. I want you to take a bath every day. But look, there's a water problem, so don't get carried away, okay? One bucket per bath for all servants. And most importantly, trust. My things. Any of my things. Better not go missing. Understand? Okay, now go. The girl got up thinking same rules everywhere. She wondered if there was a Baji rule book that they all followed religiously. She placed her hands on the cold floor to raise herself and was about to follow the tough-looking Saima when the Baji called her back. Tuba, she said, and at first the girl, unused to the new name, continued to walk. Are you deaf? The older maid nudged her. Huh? The girl turned around to see the Baji looking irritably at her as she ran her fingers through her long, expensive-looking hair. I almost forgot, the Baji said, looking sternly at her as if it were her fault. Hand over your cell phone. The girl looked at her toes, hard and stubby with chipped red polish that looked more angry than stylish. Well? She looked up to the Baji's hand, outstretched and impatient. Hurry up, she said. The girl continued to look down. Listen, I will give it to you if you need to call home, but for now, I want your mobile. Baji, she began, I... The woman leaned forward in her chair. Look, I don't allow any affairs, okay? Now hand over the phone and go. I don't have one, the girl said without looking up. The Baji stared at her in silence for a few good seconds before she spoke. Fine, if I find one on you, I'll fire you without pay. The Baji's face took on a hard, impenetrable quality, and for a moment, the girl considered surrendering her mobile. But then she thought, what if he calls? She looked down again, this time at the patterns on the plush Persian carpet and nodded mutely. Okay, the Baji said, go. Going, going, gone. The first thing the girl did as soon as they left the Baji's room was to ask for the toilet. There she squatted down on the floor, putting her phone on silent and rolled it into the waistband of her shalwar. She wondered if he would call. Their eyes had met, however briefly, in the car ride here, and she had made sure she gave her number out loud to the agent before stepping out of the car. The Baji had sent her driver to pick them up when the maid provider couldn't find the address, and in the car he had locked eyes with her in the rearview mirror. Of that, she was sure. She chewed her chadar, partly covering her face, but when she got off the car, she had turned around to look. He was looking straight at her. It had meant something, she told herself. It had to. Phone safely hidden, she emerged from the bathroom, head covered, eyes down, got to work, which was the same as in all Karachi houses. Dust, dusty, dustier. Yeah. So the story continues, but you'll have to buy the book to find out what happens next.
Kuch suspense aapke liye chhodenge hum ki kya hua uske baad. But I think the story very nicely, the passage you've read out in particular, encapsulates the general mood of this book, where there are surprises at every turn, basically. Just when you think you know where a story is headed, it heads off in another direction. And at every step, there's something new to see and something new to appreciate.
I hope so. The first part of the story may come across as a slightly elitist look at domestic staff, but the story turns. And as you read on, you will get to see how it is the maid's agency which the story is about, not so much about the suppression or the victimhood.
Absolutely. And I thought this would connect so well with what we were talking about earlier in terms of, you know, there's so many people who would be here and otherwise who would be reading your book who are going through the same process of hiring maids through agencies and who've possibly not really looked at their own behavior quite as critically as they might perhaps do after reading the story. Tell me something. So you used to be in London, is that right, earlier? And then you sort of made that shift to Karachi, presumably sort of suddenly landing up in the throes of similar concerns as the Baji.
Absolutely.
In this book. How has it been for you to make the move from there to here? And how has it affected, possibly, if at all, your writing? Is that too big a question?
Sorry. No, I think that's a really pertinent question.
Tell us
that's
everything.
A really good question. How I became a Baji.
Yeah.
I think in diasporic writing, when you're writing from far away, there's always this lens. You know, you're more focused on the bigger issues, the bigger narratives. When you are actually present in the country, when you're not an international writer writing about Pakistan, but a Pakistani writing about Pakistaniyat, you know, and even within Pakistan, there are so many Pakistans, you know, even within Karachi, there are so many little worlds. You know, when you're actually part of that world, your concerns are more everyday. And as a writer, you want to write about the things which matter to you personally. You know, there are stories in this book about people who have no idea what's happening on the bigger political arena because they're so focused on the domestic of that everyday battle of living through Karachi, you know, that battle of going to take a bath or pani nahi aa raha, you know, aapne chicken marinate karke rakh liye aur gas chali gayi hai, you know, you have to rush to work but your health hasn't showed up. Or you're a woman and you need to use the bathroom in public and there are no public toilets, you know. And those become your everyday concerns, and that is such a big lens that you're focused, that you're confronted with, that I feel my stories have become more detail-oriented, more focused on the everyday personal. I think that has been the biggest shift for me as a writer, that when I was living in London, my concerns were that of, you know, the diaspora, what language I'm writing in, what is happening to Pakistan on the global stage. But now I think they have become much more small, but much more important.
Much more important. I think that's, we have only 10 minutes left for the session to finish. And I think that's a good note on which to open this up to the audience. Is there anyone who'd like to? Yes, there is. Could we have a mic over there? So while he's getting the mic, I wanted to ask, was it hard for you to write some of these characters?
It was very hard. I think what it really forced me to confront was my own internalized patriarchy.
Right.
You know, because we grow up with such binaries in Pakistan. The media that we watch, the text that we read, we are so, it's so ingrained in us, this polarization between good girl and bad girl, that this is how a good woman behaves, this is how a bad woman behaves, that, you know, for me to write about these people as normal empowered women, I first had to confront my own prejudices.
Very interesting. Yeah. So go ahead, please.
Assalamu alaikum. Is it okay if I ask in Urdu? Will you?
Nahi, of course.
Okay. Mera sawal ye hai ki abhi jo aapne piece padha wo ek maid agency ke upar tha aur puchna ye chah rahi thi ki ye experiences jo ye aurat ye ladki face kar rahi thi ya jo uski media agency mein jo dynamics the unko understand karne ke liye ya aapki book mein bahut sari aur bhi is tarah ki stories hongi jo hamare aur aapki zindagi ke bare mein nahi hai but there are about other women jo ki pakistan mein rehti hain aur unki zindagiyan humse bilkul fark hai koi maangne wali hongi koi maids hongi jis tarah aapne bola to unki lives unki struggles understand karne ke liye kya kiya because yun to aap aur main nahi samajh sakte ki unke masle masail kya hain
तो इसके दो पार्ट्स हैं. एक तो मैं ये नहीं समझती कि एक नॉवल निगार या एक अफसाना निगार को ज़रूरी है कि वो एथनोग्राफिक रिसर्च करें टू अंडरस्टैंड इट्स यू नो बेसिकली देयर पर्सपेक्टिव उनका नज़रिया है कि उनको दुनिया किस तरह दिखती है. बट आई वॉज़ लकी इनाफ कि मैं एक प्रोफेसर भी हूँ, मैं एक यूनिवर्सिटी में काम करती हूँ एंड आई हैव एक्सेस टू एथनोग्राफिक स्टडीज़. सो आई हैड कॉलीग्स हु आर एंथ्रोपोलॉजिस्ट, हु आर एथनोग्राफर्स, हु sociologists and a lot of my research was based on case studies that they had done. There is a story in there about a colleague of mine is doing research on women in jail in Pakistani jails. So one of the stories was inspired from that. Another colleague is doing research on sex workers in Pakistan. Those stories just mein hai Radha और the date, those were based on those case studies which I had then dramatized and fictionalized. तो personally I feel I'm lucky because I have access to all this research, ethnographic studies, case studies, anthropological research. But as a fiction writer, I don't think that it is necessary that you have to go and experience the lives of others in order to write about that. Because जिस तरह गायत्री स्पिवाक ने कहा है कि यू नो यू कॉन्ट स्पीक फॉर द सबाल्टन, जो सबाल्टन जो सप्रेस्ड तबका जो है उनकी जो अपनी स्टोरी है वो तो वो सिर्फ अपने मुँह से ही बता सकते हैं. आपका अपना नज़रिया हमेशा आएगा. Your personal views are always going to infiltrate whether you're writing as a fiction writer or whether you're writing as an academic researcher. I don't think we can ever be completely unbiased. And I don't think we should be. I don't think it is the responsibility of a fiction writer to be objective or to be unbiased. I think, you know, fiction writers have very strong views and they always come in. So I don't say that I'm speaking for the less privileged or I am telling a wholly correct story of this maid. You know, I am just saying that this is a character I have created and this is how I see that character.
Okay, so we have a few more. How much time do we have left? 5 minutes?
5 minutes.
Thank you. Very prompt. And then after that, this lady. Yeah.
Sorry, I actually came to listen to your talk because I was from the title of your book it sounds as if you're writing about this change that has come in our society whereby our mothers for instance used to cover their head with a dupatta whereas now we have formally accepted and adapted to the hijab and I thought that you were going to explore the reasons for this change in our society, but from what I hear, these are various case studies about the not so privileged and the privileged classes of our society. So how does this, your title kind of coordinate what you have written and how you associate it with Hijabistan?
So we talked about this at the beginning of the talk. I'm sorry if you found my title misleading, but these stories are about the metaphorical interpretation of the hijab as the divide between women and men, women and society, women and other women. What you are talking about, there are a few stories which do address this concept of how the hijab has taken root in our society. And that story is The Urge, where the mother is talking about how with Wahhabism, with Saudi domination, with this complete erasure of our cultural history taken over by this religious identity, how more and more people are adopting the hijab rather than the chadar, which was again traditionally not so much associated with spirituality but associated with things like social mobility. So there are stories in this book which do address that, but not in a scholarly way, not in any way an objective research sense, but as a fictional commentary on our society.
Right. I think that young lady also wanted to... You're good? Okay, great.
Ji, I have a technical question. After writing long form in a novel and then writing short stories, what freedoms and constraints do you feel the different forms give you?
So I am originally a short story writer. My first love is the short story. I wrote a novel because in the publishing world, novelists are the rock stars and short story writers are, they are second class citizens. And I was told that in order to publish, it's easier if you write a novel and then you can write a short story collection. That's what most writers do. So mine was again a very technical reason for adopting the novel. But I love the short story form. I have grown up reading short stories, Urdu short stories, afsanas, digests. So that is something which comes more naturally to me. I hope having established myself as a writer, I will have more freedom to write more short stories. But even as I say this, I've been told by my publisher, next one has to be a novel.
Sabyn, thank you so much for your wonderful views on the book and on other topics that we've talked about. And thank you so much for all of you, to all of you for coming over here. Initially, when we walked in, there were only about, I think, 5 or 6 people. And it's lovely to see that the room has filled up so much. Thank you for your time.
Thank you so much.
Enjoy the rest of the festival.
Thank you so much for coming. Thank you, Afia. And the book is available at Liberty and at other bookstores in KLF. So please do get your copy. Keep reading.